I am today an out lesbian, okay, who just sued the United States of America, which is kind of overwhelming for me.
That was Edith Windsor, who had a pretty good day in court this week. The 84-year-old widow was the plaintiff who defeated the Defense of Marriage Act, or DOMA, in the U.S. Supreme Court on Wednesday. Edith married her longtime partner, Thea Spire, in Toronto. When Thea died in their home state of New York, the IRS forced Edith to pay more than $350,000 in federal estate taxes. That's a cost she wouldn't have incurred if she was married to a man. But because of DOMA, the U.S. government didn't recognize Edith and Thea's marriage as valid for tax purposes. So Edith sued, and she won. In striking down DOMA, the Supreme Court granted Edith and all other legally married gay couples in America the same federal benefits as other married couples. In a separate ruling, the court also dismissed Prop 8. That was a ban on gay marriage passed by California voters in 2008, and the ruling paves the way for same-sex marriages to resume in that state. The Supreme Court's decisions were celebrated by many, but not by all. Christopher Plant is a regional director of the National Organization for Marriage, which was the biggest contributor to putting Proposition 8 on the ballot in California. The group strongly opposes this week's ruling, and Christopher joins me now from Rhode Island. Christopher, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. Thanks for being with us. Your group has called the Wednesday Supreme Court rulings illegitimate. On what grounds are they illegitimate?
Well, primarily with the Proposition 8 decision, the Supreme Court chose to invalidate the legal votes of over 7 million California citizens who went to the polls in good faith to amend their Constitution. We don't believe the Supreme Court has that right, that role, and we certainly don't encourage anything that supports the government's ability to vacate the people's duly elected or duly voted in amendment.
Okay. And your group is trying to protect and preserve the traditional family unit, and you say you're doing that for the sake of children. But in his oral argument in the DOMA decision, Justice Kennedy said that denying same-sex marriage is really what hurts kids. So how do you reconcile that difference?
We reconcile it on a policy difference. We have to understand that we make policy not from the exception, but from the rule. And the rule throughout history is that children come from a male and a female. They come from the marriage union, and that they are ideally raised with mother and father. We don't deny that same-sex couples often do raise children and often do create good homes for those children. But in every case, they are denied either a mother and a father. So when we talk about marriage, we talk about the policy that the state should be advocating, not the exceptions that it should be legislating.
But is it now not incumbent on you to demonstrate that same-sex marriages hurt children because the Supreme Court has made a decision that it's the other way around?
We believe that social science has already made that argument very clearly over the last five decades. It's been very clear in Western countries that the demise of fatherhood, particularly in our urban centers, and the pain that that has caused children and the damage it has done to our societies when fathers are absent is a very clear case that both mothers and fathers are necessary. We've seen that even in the latest science research out of the University of Texas that clearly showed that the ideal place to raise children is with their biological mothers and fathers.
I know about this University of Texas study, but the American Sociological Association says there's no evidence that children of same-sex couples endure any harm. And they wrote a brief for this case, which says that the facts demonstrate that children fare just as well when they're raised by same-sex parents. So again, how are you going to demonstrate that same-sex marriages harm children?
Well, we demonstrated both through history that it's been very clear to humankind, not just 21st century Americans, that mothers and fathers both matter. We also understand that those cases that the American Psychological Association refer to, the 59 studies that they refer to, were all very what we call convenient samples. None of them meet the merit of a classic gold standard controlled study. And so they're making claims that they really have no scientific right to.
Well, the momentum has changed, though, as a result of what the Supreme Court decided yesterday. A lot of people are saying that this is an affirmation that same-sex marriage is becoming more accepted and more supported by Americans. And there is this Pew Research Center poll that said that 72% of Americans view legal recognition of same-sex marriage as being inevitable. So do you feel like you're swimming against the tide of history right now?
No, because actually yesterday's decision out of the Supreme Court says exactly the opposite, because the Supreme Court was asked to find a constitutional right to same-sex marriage. That is what the Proposition 8 case plaintiffs wanted. That's what attorneys Olson and Boyce demanded, and they categorically did not get that. So this puts a very large pause button on that argument of inevitability and puts it right back on the states. The Defense of Marriage Act still stands in as much as it allows the states to one by one determine their definition of marriage and to not have to recognize marriages from other states. And it puts Proposition 8 squarely back into the hands of the district court in California as we wrangle through what the court's decision yesterday means and how broad it is. We believe it's very narrow, applying only to the two couples. But it's California still has to make a decision as to how far Proposition 8 will actually go.
You just said that you believe that the decision has a narrow implication. But Justice Scalia, who wrote the dissent in the DOMA case, said that states with traditional marriage laws will likely lose at the Supreme Court as a result of that case. Is Judge Scalia wrong?
I would think that he is wrong, but, you know, that's for the tea leaf readers and the court watchers. We will continue our arguments on a state-by-state basis for now. If we see another case in the near future coming to the Supreme Court, obviously we will be vigorous before the Supreme Court to argue that marriage should be defined as one man and one woman.
This is no longer a partisan issue because dozens of prominent Republicans signed a legal brief in support of Prop 8 being struck down, and even Karl Rove, the Republican strategist, said that he would not be surprised if the 2016 Republican presidential candidate backs same-sex marriage. What does the shift in the GOP mean for your organization?
It means that there's still a lot of educating to do, particularly amongst the base of those who support marriage, one man and one woman, but to realize also that this, as you said, is not a partisan issue. There are plenty of Democrats who do not believe marriage should be redefined as well.
So very briefly, Christopher, the next battle lines for you would be where?
First in California, to sort out what the Proposition 8 case actually says. And then on a state-by-state basis, we expect Oregon and Ohio, and at least those two in the next year, to try to repeal their marriage amendments. And we will stand with those states and the people of those states and to continue to work with Congress to create more and more of a marriage culture and a marriage policy that promotes marriage as a public good.
Christopher Plant, thank you for talking to us.
Anytime.
Christopher Plant is a regional director of the National Organization for Marriage. The promise to keep fighting is likely the only thing that Christopher and our next guest have in common. Evan Wolson has been called the godfather of gay marriage. He's the founder of the U.S. organization Freedom to Marry. He joins me now from New York City. Evan, hello.
Hi, good to be with you.
Nice to have you with us. We just heard from Christopher Plant of the National Organization for Marriage, and he makes it clear that he and tens of millions of other Americans don't accept this week's rulings. So how far is this fight from being over?
Well, it's coming toward being done, but it's not done yet. We made enormous progress this week. The Supreme Court handed down two really important rulings that give added momentum to our campaign to win the freedom to marry nationwide. But there are still many more steps ahead and a lot more work to do, although I actually believe we will be able to do it and get this job done within a matter of years, not decades.
And Wednesday's decision, clearly they were a victory for your side. What were you hoping for that you didn't get on Wednesday?
Well, of course, the most wonderful result would have been an outright national ruling by the Supreme Court saying that there is a freedom to marry in the United States, and gay people cannot be denied it. And therefore, that no matter which state we live in, no matter who we are, we should have the same freedom to marry as anyone else, and affirming that all marriages must be equally and fully respected throughout the country. We got the second part, but the Supreme Court did not yet give us the first part. Instead of doing the outright national ruling, what the court did do is two things. Number one, it turned the federal government from being the number one discriminator against gay couples to now being on the side of those couples, their families, our Constitution, and our country as we move forward. What our work is to do is to now get a critical mass of states and a critical mass of public support and go back before the Supreme Court to get the national ruling. The other thing the Supreme Court did in the other case was effectively now restore the freedom to marry in California.
Yes.
California will now be an engine state helping move the country forward. And it also means, because, of course, California is our largest state, that now one-third of the American people will live in a state where gay people can marry, over 100 million people, up from zero a decade ago.
So, but let's talk about the other 37 states, because it does appear that that's where the battleground shifts to now. Does the moral weight that you're talking about, does that change the lives immediately of gay and lesbian people who live in those states who don't have marriage equality? What does the future look like for them now?
Well, the proper implementation of that ruling, striking down the Defense of Marriage Act, is that although states may discriminate until we finish that piece of the work, the federal government won't, which means that once couples are legally married, the federal government will treat them as married for federal programs and purposes, no matter where they live. That's what we're working to ensure. There will be state discrimination, and some couples will be worse off than others because of where they live and the discrimination in their state. But what we're working to achieve in the immediate aftermath of this decision is that they will at least be able to have the federal protections and responsibilities that are triggered by marriage.
Now, I want to shift to what Justice Scalia said in his dissent of the DOMA case, where he said the majority presented here a very black and white story, either hate your neighbor or come along with us. Does that kind of narrative make you uneasy?
Well, you know, Justice Scalia is prone to incendiary rhetoric and fulminations and rage, and, you know, we really weren't expecting to get his vote. So I'm not actually all that concerned with the rage he's expressing, which is way out of step with not only a majority of the American people, but fortunately, a majority of the court.
I want to go back to something else that Christopher Plunt talked about, because he says that he has proof that the children of same-sex couples suffer disadvantages compared to children raised by a married mother and father. Do you believe that your side has enough evidence to refute that?
Well, if Christopher Plant has that proof, it's kind of puzzling that he kept it secret from the trial court, where they were invited to put in whatever evidence and whatever witnesses they could come up with, and they presented zero, as was found by the trial court judge, that there was simply no evidence. That they make all kinds of statements out of court, whether it's on the radio or in TV ads or anti-gay attacks, but when they're given the opportunity to come into a courtroom with evidence, they turn out to have nothing. And in fact, there was a mountain of evidence and a flood of briefs put before the U.S. Supreme Court in just this most recent few months from child welfare associations, public health organizations, the American Medical Association, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the leading association of pediatricians, all of whom said that gay parents are doing a great job, that the kids are doing well, and that the best thing for those families would be to end the denial of marriage and give those families the respect and protections that they deserve.
Evan, in the early 1980s, you wrote your Harvard Law School thesis on freedom for gay people to marry, and that was 30 years before the question gained national prominence, and a lot of people from inside the gay movement thought you were crazy. With that in mind, what was Wednesday like for you on a personal level?
It was extremely moving. It was wonderful to know that, first of all, the lives of so many families had just improved. So it was extremely moving, both in a tangible way and when I thought about the years of working and making the case. And I remember exactly where I was when Congress passed the so-called Defense of Marriage Act. I was in Hawaii doing the world's first ever trial, in which for the first time ever we succeeded in showing that there is no good reason for gay people to be excluded from marriage. And it was that case, that trial, that launched the ongoing global movement that, you know, brought us the victory in Canada that, you know, we celebrated, and the victories in Spain and South Africa, and this year in Uruguay and New Zealand and France and Britain. And here the United States finally is catching up with countries like Canada. I remember when that law passed, I said this will not stand, and we worked hard and we made the case, and here 17 years later, the Supreme Court struck it down. And we're going to continue doing this work to bring the victory home.
President Clinton, who drafted that law, congratulated your side yesterday. Did you accept his congratulations?
Absolutely. You know, President Clinton made a mistake. He did the wrong thing in 1996, but he had the decency to dig into his heart and to listen to the stories of real families and talk with gay people, and he was big enough to change his mind. He was big enough to say, I was wrong, and now I understand, and I've gone on a journey, and that's the same journey that the majority of Americans have now taken.
Evan Wolfson, thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.
That was Evan Wolfson, the founder of Freedom to Marry. This is Day 6.
Day 6.
Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We're at CBC Day 6.